A very good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from John Swinney, and I welcome Jackie Dunbar to the meeting as a committee substitute. Welcome, Jackie. Our first agenda item this morning is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Okay, thank you. So our first item of business today is the continuation of evidence on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. And as a reminder, we're at phase one of our scrutiny of the bill, and today's evidence will focus on parts 1 to 3 of the bill. So I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting this morning Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Ms Heather Tully, Criminal Justice Reform Unit, Criminal Justice Division, Ms Lucy Smith, Victims and Witnesses Unit at the Criminal Justice Division, Mr Simon Stockwell, Family Law Policy Unit, Civil Law and Legal System Division, and Kirsty Anderson, Solicitor, Legal Directorate at the Scottish Government. So welcome all. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I intend to allow about 90 minutes for this session. So can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. The Victims, Witness and Justice Reform Bill puts victims at the heart of the justice system. Parts 1 to 3 of the bill are central to delivery of that ambition, and I will just go over the aims of these parts briefly. Part 1 of the bill, to establish an independent Victims and Witness Commissioner, will give victims an independent voice, champion their views and hold justice agencies to account. As part of the Commissioner's role will be to monitor how agencies are complying with the Standards of Service and the Victims Code. There is long-standing and clear demand from victims for this role. The issue has been discussed at the Victims Task Force over a number of years, and our public consultation revealed strong support. The bill is delivering on a commitment made to victims and to the wider public via our manifesto and programme for government to establish such a post. The role will benefit victims and witnesses of crime by providing a statutory mechanism for their voices and experiences to be heard. Part 2 of the bill aims to put trauma-informed practice at the heart of decision-making in the justice system to improve people's experiences of justice and help them participate effectively. I have followed the committee's scrutiny of these parts of bill with interest. I am pleased that there has been universal agreement amongst your witnesses that the justice system must operate in a trauma-informed way. The committee has heard from experts about the ways trauma can affect people, and victims and survivors have spoken powerfully about the lasting impacts of trauma and how the justice process itself can be re-traumatising. We can't remove all risk of traumatisation from the justice system, but the bill puts in place measures that aim to minimise that risk. If people are treated in trauma-informed ways, that can help keep them engaged with the justice process, help ensure trauma doesn't stop them participating effectively, and help them to give their best evidence. As well as significantly improving the experiences of witnesses themselves, this can improve the quality of the justice process for everyone involved. The bill builds on work already underway by justice partners and aims to embed the principles of trauma-informed practice within our justice system. The bill includes a definition of trauma-informed practice, helping to ensure a consistent understanding and approach. It requires justice agencies to make efforts to reduce re-traumatisation and to publish standards on trauma-informed practice. The bill also requires the judiciary to take trauma-informed practice into account when scheduling court business and empowers the courts to set rules designed to ensure that proceedings are conducted in trauma-informed ways. Convener, Part 3 of the bill covers special measures in civil cases. Special measures protect people in court who might be vulnerable, and the provisions are a reflection that domestic abuse can arise in civil cases as well as in criminal cases. The existing legislation on special measures covers civil cases as well as criminal cases. However, there have been requests over the years to improve the legislation on special measures in relation to civil cases. The Children's Scotland Act 2020 includes provisions to enhance special measures in some cases. This Act was, of course, just about family cases. The bill is an opportunity to extend the provisions to cases generally. Convener, the bill is central to the delivery of our vision for justice and brings forward proposals for transformational change to the system which have emerged from respected review processes and directly from victims themselves. The government is acting on the evidence and what we have heard from those with experience of the system. And importantly, convener, the bill is the government's response to what we have heard from victims. And I look forward to committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. So we'll move on to questions now. I intend to invite questions firstly on part one of the bill, and then we'll move on to parts two and part three in turn. So I wonder if I can begin with a general question on part one. The proposal around the establishment of a victims commissioner. So we've heard mixed views on this proposal. Some witnesses are clearly very supportive, but others have raised some concerns. For example, is it the best use of limited resources? Do we need another commissioner? And a possible conflict with, for example, the role of the Lord Advocate. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what her reflections are on some of the concerns that have been raised?
Thanks very much, Convener, and it's a good place to start. I suppose in response to your question, I would want to reiterate and expand upon what I've said in and around the case for a Victims and Witness Commissioner and the support for our proposition. And also, you know, to acknowledge some of those concerns about costs and your point in relation to the Lord Advocate's powers. We are all, of course, you know, operating in a fiscal reality. But, of course, there is provisions in the bill which can enable the Victims and Witness Commissioner to share back office functions. A number of commissioners already do this. The bill doesn't disqualify an existing commissioner from being appointed to this role. Any commissioner would need to comply with the corporate body in and around things like the location office. And of course, many commissioners are either in shared premises down in Bridgeside House in Leith, or they're within the existing Scottish Government estate or the existing public sector estate. In terms of the case for a commissioner, this is essentially about the need for an independent voice, a champion, who will, of course, challenge criminal justice agencies. But the role also brings, and I mentioned this in opening remarks, that additional statutory mechanism that enables voices and experiences to be heard. So a key role of the commissioner is monitoring compliance, you know, with the victim's code and the standards of service, including the requirement for agencies to actively demonstrate trauma-informed practice and in that manner monitor how the rights of victims and witnesses are being respected, and of course they are accountable to Parliament. I would also like to say that this proposition has been developed over a number of years. From the work of the Victims Task Force, they had produced a paper back in 2020. And Victim Support Scotland produced a paper called Making the Case for a Victims and Witness Commissioner. And essentially, their case hinged around that need for victims and witnesses to be heard and to be able to influence systemic change and change at that strategic level. And I was very struck by the correspondence from Lynn Burns when she said it was an opportunity for a commissioner to represent all victims, And that's different from the role of individual agencies. And that in many ways, it was a first step. And that's probably why it's part one of the bill. And she, you know, described it as that conduit, again, at that strategic and systemic level between government, justice agencies and people who are affected by crime. Mm-hmm. And just quickly, Convener, in terms of the Lord Advocate's powers, I am clear that there is nothing in this bill that in any way interferes or disrupts the Lord Advocate's constitutional powers with respect to prosecution decisions and her other functions. What this bill does is that it acknowledges the role of the Crown Office and that they have functions that have an impact on the treatment of victims. And it is my view that a Victims and Witness Commissioner should be able to make recommendations, but only in respect of the Lord Advocate's functions in relation to the treatment of victims, mm-hmm. not those powers where only the Lord Advocate mm-hmm. has the constitutional authority to undertake.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, that's a really helpful update. I've got a couple of supplementary questions I might come back to later if we've got time, but I am going to open it up to members now, and I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay and then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I just wanted to... Thanks for that helpful overview of it. I think there's a lot covered in that. I just wanted to pick up one part of it, just for clarification. You said that it's possible that it's open to an existing commissioner, and I wondered what you meant by that in terms of, do you mean that they would take on this as an additional role or as part of their portfolio and not have an individual victims commissioner? Is that what you meant?
So the legislation is for a distinct role of victims and witness commissioner. It just doesn't disqualify an existing commissioner from taking on that role. But I will ask our lawyer just to confirm that I have articulated that accurately for the record. Or maybe Lucy?
Yes, perhaps Lucy.
From policy.
It's fixed. Thank you. Yes, the provisions in Schedule 1, they set out about the appointment for the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. And in that, it says that it does not prevent an existing commissioner from having this function. The function cannot be given to another public body, but it could be given to a commissioner. Mm-hmm. If the committee, if Parliament chose that, it could be an option rather than a specific separate body.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. That's interesting. Thank you.
Okay. Fulton McGregor, then Sharon Dowie.
Secretary and officials. It was actually following on from Rona Mackay's question there, and we've heard some concern from the Children and Young People's Commissioner, for example, about a lack of clarity between their role and the proposed Victim and Witnesses Commissioner, or you know, an overlap. Is that something that the government have looked at? Do you think that there might be a case to make that clearer?
So it is an issue that we've been conscious of, and that's because of some of the policy areas in terms of improving the experience and support available for children witnesses. So if you think of the work around the Bairns House, that's cross portfolio work. I suppose the Children and Young Persons Commissioner role, I would say, is an example of the role and the model of a commissioner working well. It is correct to say that the victim code and the standards of service that agencies, criminal justice agencies, are held to account for do specify children. So we have been working to ensure that the connectivity between the Children and Young People's Commissioner and a victims and witness commissioner, that there is the appropriate links, but not duplication. So if I can give you an example, section 10 in the bill, say, you know, gives the commissioner powers to carry out an investigation, but not to duplicate the function of others. So the bill, in how it's crafted, is trying to ensure that, you know, we're having clarity as opposed to confusion, and that this commissioner can't, you know, go into the functions and duties of another commissioner, or indeed another body. Although Section 6 does empower the Victims Witness Commissioner to engage with the Children and Young People's Commissioner as well. So we want to ensure, you know, as much clarity as possible. If there are other matters we need to, you know, in light of the evidence, resolve, if there's further detailed consideration that needs to be given, we'll certainly do that.
Thank you. That's, I'm happy with that.
Okay, thank you very much. Sharon Dowie, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Just going back to some of your earlier comments, you said it was a statutory mechanism for the voices and experience to be heard of victims. You've also said it would give them an independent voice, a champion, and it would monitor compliance. But we've already got a lot of groups and organisations out there that could do that same function. Rape Crisis Scotland, Victim Support, Scottish Women's Aid have all expressed concern that the funding for the Commissioner shouldn't take away from the frontline services that they provide. And the Finance Committee has also expressed concerns, saying it's becoming regarded as a casual thing to suggest and implement the establishment of another commissioner, despite it being an expensive extension of our public sector. So we all know that finances are finite. We're going to have to find the money from somewhere. So where is the money coming from? And can you guarantee that it's not going to take away from the frontline services that we've already got?
So it's a completely different function from the role and purpose of frontline services. And Ms Dowie's quite right that investment in a victims and witness commissioner should not be taken from frontline services. We do, of course, operate within a fiscal envelope. And, you know, I understand and I'm very respectful of the fact that people have a duty to test the costs and the detail in financial memorandums with any new proposition. I suppose what I would dispute is that the, and I know you were quoting the correspondence from the Finance Committee, is I can confidently say in this consideration of a Victims and Witness Commissioner that this is not been a casual approach. And that's because of the work that has taken place over a number of years. The work from the Victims Task Force, the work of Victim Support Scotland, our own work in terms of the consultation for this bill. So I would dispute any inference that our proposal to bring forward a Victims and Witness Commissioner, that is in any way casual. And it is a direct response to a direct demand from victims and witnesses themselves. I think where it's designed to complement and not duplicate the role of frontline services, and if I can give, you know, maybe some examples. The Commissioner has broad powers that frontline agencies don't. The Commissioner will have powers that will require the agency to provide information to determine whether it's compliance with the, you know, updated Victims Code and Service of Standards. You know, the Commissioner will have a duty to publish reports and recommendations, and it will have the powers, the Commissioner will have the powers to impose a requirement on agencies for them to respond to any report made by the Commissioner, and for any statements to be published when they, you know, receive a response from agencies to the recommendations. So the role of the Commissioner is very much about that structural and systemic change, and is distinct from the role of individual agencies who are supporting either individuals or providing frontline services.
You said in your opening statement as well about how all the organisations are supportive of bringing in trauma-informed practices, though. So would the money not be better spent? They've already highlighted all the issues that we've got. So would that money not be better spent going and fixing the things that we already know that are wrong? Because the money's going to have to come from somewhere.
The money is going to have to come from somewhere. And I think after the session we had last week on pre-budget scrutiny, I think we're all well appraised of the challenges that we face. I would still contend that there is added value and therefore a merit to investment in a victims and witness commissioner, because it will hold criminal justice agencies to account on how they implement and how they put into practice trauma-informed approaches.
Okay, thank you very much. Russell Finlay and then Pauline McNeill.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a continuation of the line of questioning from my colleague Sharon Dowie. Now, Police Scotland and the Crown Office have both written to the Finance Committee with concerns about the Bill's financial memorandum. And the Finance Committee convener has written to our committee convener and to yourself about this. Now, some of the biggest concerns relate to the cost of sex crime courts, which is part 5 of the bill, and therefore for another day. But he also cites the cost of the Commissioner as an area of concern. So in light of this, is the Scottish Government doing any work to revisit, reassess or re-evaluate the cost of this bill?
So, in terms of any financial memorandum, when it's produced, it is based on the detailed evidence that is available at the time. I would like to stress that we have engaged extensively with our stakeholders and partners who will ultimately have operational responsibility to deliver many aspects of the bill. And I think we were very transparent and upfront around the financial memorandum. I think the costs are far easier to define for parts 1, 2 and 3 that we're discussing this morning. There are other parts of the bill, and Mr Finlay is right to point to this, that there are other parts of the bill where estimates have been given, where minimum costs have been given, and that is in recognition due to variables and operational decisions that have yet to be made.
Is it being re-evaluated or reassessed? Or?
It's an ongoing process. It's an ongoing process, and I have, of course, received correspondence from the Finance Committee in that regard, and will continue to engage.
So, in general terms, a financial memorandum accompanying a bill is always a work in progress. It's got the capacity to change as the bill evolves.
That's been my experience, right, as a minister in a number of portfolios. I mean, I appreciate that you want to establish as much information about the costs as early as possible. That's in the interest of transparency and accountability to Parliament and committees. But bearing in mind the work that goes on in and around a bill, and in particularly around the implementation and indeed the purpose of scrutiny and evidence, it does mean that there are times that financial memorandums are revisited.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, in opening you said that a commissioner would have the ability to hold agencies to account. The Law Society has highlighted that the bill does not contain any enforcement mechanism in the event of any agencies failing to cooperate with the commissioner. So, in other words, the police and the Crown Office theoretically at least could ignore the Commissioner, not engage with the Commissioner, and there would be nothing anyone could apparently do about that. Will this gap in the bill be addressed by the Scottish Government?
So I wouldn't articulate that as a gap, Mr. Finlay, just purely on the basis that the model for a commissioner and for the Victims and Witness Commissioner is in line with the model of most other commissioners. And I'm not aware of, goodness, you may well stand to be corrected, but by and large, commissioners are accountable to Parliament. So if they are reporting on significant abdication of duty or non-compliance with legislation or indeed standards of service, that information is made available to Parliament, and of course it's for parliamentarians to consider what further action would be appropriate.
So essentially Parliament would need to address any potential non-compliance that wouldn't be part of the bill, because that would be inconsistent with other commissioners?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, thank you. An extension of that is the belief or the view from Crown Office and Police Scotland that the commissioner shouldn't be allowed to become involved in individual cases. They claim that doing so would potentially prejudice legal proceedings. Do you believe that it's actually reasonable and straightforward to empower the commissioner to act in certain cases without interfering with justice?
So, again, we have carefully looked at that, bearing in mind that there is operational independence for our courts and prosecutors, and it's not in anybody's interest for those processes to be interfered with, and that ultimately the Victims and Witness Commissioner is about amplifying the voices of victims and witnesses to ensure better consistent systemic level change. The Commissioner can engage with individuals and can consider the individual experiences of people, but that is to improve the understanding of the national picture. And bearing in mind the discussions we've had so far about concerns about duplication and costs, I'm satisfied that the Commissioner, as with other commissioners, doesn't take on or intervene in individual cases.
Okay. I mean, I've had dealings with the Children's Commissioner in relation to a specific case of a baby that died, and I didn't realise perhaps they were going beyond their remit, and I know you can't speak for that, but surely there will be cases, by the very nature of the criminal justice system, that do require the Commissioner to engage and perhaps take some form of immediate intervention or action.
So as I've said, in terms of the purpose of this Commissioner, and you know, we can establish this, but it's not an uncommon model for commissioners that they can, of course, look at individual cases and engage on individual cases, but that's with a view not to acting in individual cases, but that is with a view to the wider systems change, whether that's, you know, it's not common for commissioners to call for change in policy or to call for change in legislation or to call for action, but that's at a systems-wide level, you know, based on the knowledge and understanding of an individual case or indeed many individual cases.
Thanks very much. Thank you. Thanks.
Pauline McNeill.
Good morning. So I begin by stating what I already said on record, which is I've never been keen on the idea of a lot of different commissioners. And at the moment, I'm struggling to see what this proposal would actually do to make any difference to victims. However, try to keep an open mind. My first question relates to, it's kind of follow on from Russell Finlay's. I mean, the rule of law itself dictates a separation between Parliament and the courts, and as you've said already, the Lord Advocate has a statutory legal function and is independent in itself. So it's not really possible to create a commission that has any powers that can challenge any of these statutory bodies, and if it did, it would be interfering with the rule of law and the independence of the Crown. So Is that not the first problem?
So, as I think I outlined in my question to Ms Dowie, or I'm sorry, my answer to Ms Dowie, the Commissioner would have broad powers that requires criminal justice agencies to provide evidence and to give evidence on any investigations that the Commissioner undertook. It would require agencies to provide clear information that they are, that they are, compliant with trauma-informed practice, that they are adhering to the victim's code and standards of service, and like other commissioners, there would be a duty to publish reports and to make recommendations that would all be on the public record. And they can impose a requirement on agencies to respond to a report, and the Commissioner themselves could or has to publish statements on responses that they've received in response to recommendations or reports that they've made. And that is a well-established model that, in my view, I think perhaps the best example is how well that has worked with the Children and Young People's Commissioner, which has certainly been part of the dialogue and has certainly been a role that has contributed to many policy and legislative changes in this Parliament, and over the history of this Parliament has shifted and changed our dialogue on how we support children and young people. And what victims and witnesses are seeking to achieve here is a commissioner that is on a par with the Children and Young People's Commissioner.
But surely there's a big difference between a commission, the Children's Commissioner, that's not dealing with the court system or the Crown Office. Surely the distinction here is that you want to create a commission that cannot interfere with the statutory functions. So I took your point about the Children's Commissioner being able to influence the definition of a child, for example. But I don't think there's a kind of straightforward comparison here. So the sort of things that we are hearing from victims that, in terms of their experiences, long delays, a failure for the Crown and the police to communicate properly, the court experience itself, the physicality of the court, and giving evidence, all of which the bill is trying to deal with anyway, in terms of trauma-informed, commission, given evidence by a commission. I'm actually struggling to see, other than, as you said there, Cabinet Secretary, say, well, report to me on these. They can't go beyond that in any way.
So, I mean, I suppose I would point to the fact that by comparison, the Children and Young People's Commissioner is also operating in an environment that is quite legislation heavy in terms of the children's hearing system, for example. And, there are a small proportion of children and young people that become involved in the criminal justice system, for example. So I do think it is a fair comparison. And all the things that you mentioned in terms of court rules and procedures, scheduling, the environment, pre-recorded evidence, they all have a direct link with trauma-informed practice and trauma-informed approaches. And while the operational delivery of these matters rests elsewhere, the purpose of the bill in cementing and placing duties on people to demonstrate trauma-informed practice is a lever. It's not the only lever, but it's certainly a lever in changing how operational decisions are made and implemented.
Does it not also call into question then the existence of a commissioner? And I have to say, the excellent work that Victim Support have done, which is government funded and has been a champion for victims, appeared before this committee on many occasions. So does it not compromise the funding of a third sector organisation that already has been quite effective?
So, actually, Victim Support Scotland have been one of the biggest advocates for a Victims and Witness Commissioner and published a paper making the case for a Victims Witness Commissioner in 2021. And I know that Victim Support Scotland and Kate Wallace has given evidence to this committee.
Mm-hmm. But you don't see any compromise having to be made, between the Victims Commissioner and the role of a very effective victims organisation? You don't see any...
I don't, Ms McNeill. I think they're distinct roles that complement each other, and, I think I've given some clarity that in terms of learning from how commissioners are established more broadly, to how we've taken efforts to ensure that there isn't inappropriate duplication. And to be honest, my experience is as a minister, where you would have dealings with independent commissioners. Your dealings with commissioners is always quite formal, a few times a year, arm's length, there'd be an exchange of correspondence, but actually your engagement with stakeholders and frontline organisations is always more intense and more frequent.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you. Before we move on to part two, I wonder if I can just come in with a final question. And it relates to British Transport Police. So BTP sent in a written submission and in relation to parts one and two of the bill, they were questioning why BTP wasn't being treated as or considered to be a justice agency in the same way as Police Scotland. And you'll maybe be aware that BTP were actually in the Parliament just the other week. And they spoke about a range of things, including their Guardian app, which enables travellers to report crimes and offences while travelling. But certainly from the conversation I had, they were quite keen that was extended to women and obviously was relevant to safe travel for women. So I just wondered if there are some difficulties in and around this, and if so, if the Scottish Government is perhaps looking at ways to ensure that status, if you like, doesn't hinder the sort of objectives of this bill that we're looking at.
So, yes, the British Transport Police do great work. They work, as we all know, state and office here across these islands. It is important to stress that we'll always have further discussions with agencies, whether it's the British Transport Police or others, if there is more they are seeking to do, particularly in pursuit of the aims of this bill. The purpose of our investment in the knowledge and skills framework for the justice sector, so there's that practical guide and support in terms of the implementation of trauma-informed practice. It's clear that the British Transport Police are undertaking many initiatives to put that into practice. We're happy to explore that more with them. I suppose in terms of this legislation, this legislation builds on previous legislation. So the agencies that have duties placed upon them in this bill are ones that are listed in the Victims and Witness 2014 Act. Of course, we're cognisant that the British Transport Police operate in other areas, and our legislation can only apply to our operations in Scotland. But yeah. I mean, our doors open. I mean, if there's more that we can do to work with the British Transport Police or to work in partnership. And, you know, I'm also conscious that we're the first jurisdiction in the UK to legislate to put trauma-informed practice into the very heart of legislation in our justice system, and mm-hmm. we will want to share that with others mm-hmm. And work with others.
Thanks very much for that. That's a helpful open door. And that will maybe help us segue into looking at part two of the bill around embedding trauma-informed practice. So, again, if I may just kick things off with a question. So we heard, I think, a couple of weeks ago some excellent evidence from Dr. Caroline Bruce and Professor Karatias from Edinburgh Napier University on trauma-informed practice. And one point that made by Professor Katias was in response to a question about sort of whole system embedding of trauma-informed practice. And he spoke about the principles of trauma-informed practice are quite general around safety, choice, collaboration, trustworthiness, and empowerment, but that different elements may apply in different parts of the justice sector. So, for example, perhaps within a court setting, the principles around safety and choice may be more relevant, while in prisons, elements or principles around recovery may be more important and more relevant. So I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary considers that this whole system application of trauma-informed practice as set out as an example by Professor Karatias, if the provisions of the bill will support this?
So, in broad terms, yes. So, the provisions in the bill are trying to do two things. So, we do indeed want systemic change. We want a shared understanding, a consistency of approach. We want all that on the one hand, but there is a recognition that justice agencies will need a flexibility to implement in a way that's tailored to their context for the very reasons that you've outlined, convener. Mm-hmm. And the bill does this by creating a statutory definition of trauma-informed practice that is requiring agencies to have regard to trauma-informed practice and their work with victims and witnesses. And it's crafted in a way that, for example, it's empowering courts to set rules and procedures on trauma-informed practice, both in criminal and civil business. And in terms of how trauma-informed practice is defined, again, that's been informed by the trauma-informed knowledge and skills framework for the justice sector, although as with any legal definition, it has to fit into legislation, and you know, quite often, as with this bill, you know, some definitions and you know are dependent on previous legislation. So we're not, as with any legislation, you're not starting from scratch. Mm-hmm.
So just in follow-up to that then, if we're looking at a whole system sort of embedding of trauma-informed practice, if the, as and when, if the bill is passed, then would there be some provision put in place to support the implementation of a whole system approach and embedding? What would be the early work that might be required around that?
So actually we've started that early mm-hmm. work, and colleagues will remember the debate we held in Parliament yep. before summer recess, and that was really shining a light on the publication of the knowledge and skills framework. And as members in that debate, I think Ms McNeill in particular commented, there's a substantive document. I mean, it runs to about 250 pages. And, you know, so there's the toolkit, and I know, and I'm quite sure committee knows from the evidence that is heard, that many of our stakeholders and agencies, you know, are already, you know, running with that work. Mm-hmm. So that work doesn't depend on legislation. What legislation does is it gives a permanency to change and cements change into the system and imposes duties on players in that system to demonstrate that they are meeting these objectives and this way of working.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Sharon Dowie and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you. I was actually looking at the definition of trauma-informed practice. So we've heard from lots of the criminal justice agencies that have given us evidence, and a lot of them have started bringing in trauma-informed practice, but without legislation at the moment. When we had NHS Scotland, and they suggested there would be benefits in extending the definition. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts on that were, and if we don't get the definition right, do we run the risk of organisations only working up to the letter of the law and then not actually going above and beyond that to try and keep finding new ways to improve?
So we'll always have an open mind and, you know, an open door to having engagement on the detail. I suppose the only caveat is that it is important that legislation brings, you know, clarity of meaning and purpose, and that there's never any kind of, you know, unintended consequences by, you know, changing the letter of the law. As I intimated earlier to the convener, the legal definition is closely aligned to the knowledge and skills framework and all that work undertaken by NES and Dr. Caroline Bruce. It is, of course, it's not exactly the same word for word, just because this bill doesn't exist in isolation from other legislation, and that we are what the bill's doing is that it's adding trauma-informed practice to an existing list of principles that's in the 2014 Act.
OK. And just coming back to costs again, some of the justice agencies, including police and prosecution, have raised concerns about limited resources. So, again, what conversations have you had with them about resources? And, again, once we put the legislation in, is there a risk that to comply with legislation, that other things, as you mentioned, unintended consequences earlier on, so is there a risk that they focus on the legislation and then with unintended consequences when the money and the resources have to come from other areas?
So let me assure members that there are always lots of discussions about resources with our partners on an ongoing basis. I do think in terms of the costs for parts 1, 2 and 3 of the bill, I think they're pretty well defined and clear. I am conscious that for some of our organisations, like the Scottish Courts and Tribunal System, in terms of their overall budget and the overall size of their operation, they are smaller in comparison to, say, Police Scotland. So we do have to give, you know, some cognizance to smaller organisations. But we should also remember, and this is, you know, it's appropriate for me also to test any supplementary evidence that comes from stakeholders about costs, is that this isn't all about additional resource, not demurring from the reality that there is a cost to this bill. But actually, some of this isn't about additional duties. Some of this is about changing what we do at a core level. And I would actually argue for the overall system that if we get it right and embed trauma-informed practice, that in many ways that supports and encourages a more efficient justice system, and particularly around, you know, in terms of how we schedule, how the implementation of trauma-informed practice really is a clarion call to organise the system to reduce delays. So it is all interrelated. But I do think some of this is about approach, culture and practice, as well as resources.
I would agree with that, but I think initially to put it into practice, there's going to be a cost. And we obviously get the letter that came in last night, and all the way through that letter, there is reference to financial constraints, and that's why a lot of previous legislation hasn't been implemented. So I would be concerned that because of the cost of implementing this, there could be unintended consequences where other things get left to the side and we actually end up inadvertently causing more trauma to victims. Just one last one on the Pro Board. The Pro Board said they were not confident the bill would change the traumatic experience of victims going through the Pro Board process. So do you have any plans to make more specific provisions relating to the Pro Board and the legislation in order to change that?
So the Pro Board is a legal entity and has an interface with victims and witnesses. So therefore, like other criminal justice agencies, it will have to demonstrate its compliance to trauma-informed practice as per the provisions in the legislation. The other aspect of policy is the review of the victim's notification scheme that has a particular relevance to the work of the Parole Board. There was a review undertaken. That work was published in May this year. There was there 22 recommendations. We are working through those recommendations, and I would hope that we will be in a position to, you know, inform Parliament in terms of a response to that independent inquiry. So that is, and some of those recommendations, you know, will be of particular relevance to the Pro Board.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Rona Mackay, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I wanted to ask you, sort of following on from your comments about changing practice and culture to become trauma-informed, I wanted to ask you about floating trials in solemn cases. We've heard from witnesses and from some women's organisations that they're prolong the trauma and they just prolong the anxiety for instance, rape complainers. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service have defended their use, and there's nothing in the bill to actually address this. Can I ask for your thoughts on floating trial diets, and can you understand the anxiety that they claim to cause the victims?
So I should acknowledge that there is a debate around this, and it's in many ways a live debate between different stakeholders and indeed different voices within the legal establishment. I would certainly acknowledge that uncertainty for victims is undesirable, and that the government's position is that we are supportive in reducing the use of floating trials. We have not brought forward any measures to ban the use of floating trials. And in essence, that's because we are still tackling a court backlog. While the court recovery programme is making good progress, it's reduced the backlog by a third, and, you know, there's a timetable of activity to move matters forward. The concern is that to remove floating trials at this time could actually increase delays further, and that would induce further distress. So we have taken a more flexible approach, whereby courts would be required to consider trauma-informed practice when scheduling their business. But we are supportive of a shift in culture, definitely.
Thank you. So the ultimate aim would be, when the time is right, not to have these floating trial diets at all?
I certainly want to see them reduced, and I would certainly also acknowledge that it's a matter of live debate just now. I need to be cognizant of a range of voices. I know that uncertainty for victims is a real factor that causes real distress. I am just somewhat cautious that at this point in time, that if we took a more inflexible approach, that would actually cause further harm and distress. So I do think, a more flexible approach is the appropriate response.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Russell Finlay, then Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you very much. And it's written evidence to the committee, NHS Education Scotland for Scotland says that the bill's definition of trauma-informed should align with its five-point definition, which was published this year. But the bill doesn't include two of their 5 points. They say that this is the word they use is essential, that it should. And not only that, but leaving them out may hinder implementation of other parts of the bill. And they want Scottish Government to look at this again. So will you?
Well, our door is always open, particularly at stage one. The purpose of stage one and people being able to provide evidence has a benefit both to MSPs and also the government. I suppose I would refer, Mr. Finlay, to what I said earlier, that the definition aligns closely to the trauma-informed practice framework, and it is also adding to the existing list of principles that are contained in an earlier bit of legislation. But if Mr. Finlay or others want to be specific about what they think is missing, we can, of course, go and check whether it's
I'm just putting to you what their written evidence to the committee has been, which is obviously available to the government. Now, John Watt of the Parole Board has told us that we need, and I quote, a complete review of the system from the ground right up, while Chief Superintendent Derek Frew of Police Scotland told us that the trauma experienced by victims and their families of the justice system, and again I quote, will not be fixed by what is in the bill, which won't, and again quoting, solve the systemic issues. So given the evidence of both Mr. Watt and Chief Superintendent Frew, would a ground-up review not have been a much more sensible starting point than this costly and cumbersome legislation?
With respect, Mr. Finlay, I would point to the Lady Dorian review into the management of sexual offences cases, which this bill is largely developed from. That was a clean sheet approach, and it was a substantive piece of work that took place over 2 years. I do think it is always fair to acknowledge that no bit of legislation is ever the silver bullet, but this is a substantial piece of legislation. Yes, it doesn't come without its financial costs, but it's a substantial piece of legislation that will make historic changes that will benefit victims and witnesses and crucially improve the experience that victims and witnesses have of our current court procedures in particular.
But when you've got a senior Police Scotland officer telling the committee that the problems won't be fixed by what's in the bill, does that not cause you some concern?
Well, I mean, I have read Mr. Watt's comments.
This is Mr. Frew's comment.
And Mr. Frew's, yep. I was just about Sorry. To mention. the Chief Superintendent Frew, Mr. Finlay. I mean, the Chief Superintendent was, you know, talking about, a local policing context, you know, working with community planning partnerships. And I think he was certainly reflected on matters at, a level, beyond this bill. And I'm not sure he was given a direct comment specifically on this bill, but I mean, members here will who were present at the time will have their own views on that. And my understanding, looking at the official record, Mr. Finlay and your exchange, a quite lengthy exchange with Mr. Watt over the parole board, that some of that was quite specific to how the parole board engages with victims or those who are registered under the victims.
Which brings us back to one of the questions someone else asked about the parole board not being part of the bill's remit, which you've already answered.
I've already answered that, they are, because the parole board is the legal entity, is a listed agency.
When you were here 7 weeks ago, I asked about the requirement for judges to be trauma-informed, but the bill says this will be up to the Lord President to decide exactly what that will look like. Now, if the bill is going to create time and effort to implement trauma-informed practice throughout the justice system, should it not be more specific? And in light of that point raised 7 weeks ago, is that being revisited, or are you happy with the bill as is?
So I'm going to ask officials to speak on that point, but there is certainly not an obligation on those who participate, and this is a part of the bill that will come to later in Part 5. There is an obligation on all the actors and players in the Sexual Offences Court to be trauma-informed. And there is certainly a desire and a commitment for the judiciary.
I mean, it's specifically on
the provisions of the bill.
Says that the judiciary will, once the bill's enacted, then decide what that looks like.
Yeah.
Should it not actually state what it looks like up front?
Heather.
Just to add to what the Cabinet Secretary has said, I think the committee heard last week from David Fraser and indeed from Dr. Caroline Bruce about the considerable training on trauma-informed practice that has already been developed and delivered by the Judicial Office, which leads on training for the judiciary and on the high quality of that training. I think they were perhaps the first organisation or one of the first that Dr. Caroline Bruce has worked with quite extensively on the development of their own training. So it is something that they already have put considerable resource and time into developing. As the Cabinet Secretary has said, when it comes to Part 5 of the bill in the specialist court, there is, of course, a requirement that the judiciary, like the other players in that court, will have undergone trauma-informed training.
Is this provided by the Judicial Institute for Scotland?
Yes, the Judicial Institute for Scotland lead on the development and the delivery of all training for the judiciary.
OK, thank you for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Fulton McGregor, then Pauline McNeill.
Thanks, Convener. And I think we have actually covered quite a lot under trauma-informed practice already, so it's really quite a general question for me, in touching on something the Cabinet Secretary's already raised. Clearly, from the evidence we've heard, there is a lot of good trauma-informed practice already happening in the justice system, albeit perhaps in patches, throughout different organisations. Another one of the other things that I think everybody recognises, and we've heard from various people telling us about their experience, that often the justice system itself re-traumatises victims. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, I actually did have another question before I changed this general one, but a lot of it's been covered, but is the purpose of this part of the bill and bringing trauma-informed practice into legislation really to try and drive that culture change? Look at the good things that are happening and try and replicate it across services quicker than would maybe happen without legislation.
In short, Convener, yes. I mean, we know from a series of reports dating back to about 2017. Various reports, you know, that started with a thematic review of investigation and prosecution services, you know, a real close look at the justice journeys, reviews of victim care that was undertaken by Leslie Thompson KC, and other work, and then we have Lady Dorian's work, where she said that trauma-informed practice is a central way in which the experience of complainers can be improved. So I do believe the bill, you know, will help bring forward that systems-wide change. While, and I said this in the opening statement, you can never remove risk entirely, because part of the process, part of the process of going through the justice system is that people will have to, in some shape or form, recount very difficult traumatic experiences. But where we can reduce that risk of re-traumatising, ensure people can continue to be engaged with the justice system and not fall out of the process, and that they're given the appropriate support to give their best evidence. And that's not compromising anybody else's rights, but it's in the interest of justice that complainers and witnesses are able to give the best of evidence. Because at the end of the day, we all just want to get, in any individual case, the desire is to get to the truth. And our system, a cornerstone of our system, is fairness. And we have to do that in a way that does not have a disregard for the welfare of people that are participating in our justice system.
Polly McNeill.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, I think you've partially covered the question I was going to ask, but just for the record, when you said there was going to, you know, will be a certain element of risk, and the important thing is we have a system that lets victims tell their stories, and that they fully get out in court the voice they want to give to what happened to them. But there is a fine line between that and cross-examination of the, whatever you think of the system we have, is the system we have, and you're not proposing to change the adversarial nature of it. I just wondered, had you had any discussions with the profession? Had any concerns been raised with the government during the passage of the bill about the balance between trauma-informed practice and the process of cross-examination in court?
Yes, again, lots of discussions with lots of stakeholders and people who, you know, operate in the courts on a day-to-day basis. So, as you'd expect, I have engaged with, you know, whether it's the Faculty of Advocates, criminal defence lawyers, victim support organisations, and the purpose of the Lady Dorian review was to look at how we could improve the experience of victims going through the justice system without compromising the rights of the accused. So there is always a balance. I won't repeat what I said around the kind of series of reports that point to a body of evidence about the system as a whole. We have had lots of very, and I'm sure the committee has as well, very powerful personal testimony on the emotional toll of being a complainer or victim. I do also know that there are criminal defence lawyers that have been absolute champions of the trauma-informed approach. I'm thinking in particular of Ian Smith, who I had dealings with in my days and my drugs policy days as Minister for Drugs Policy. So, yes, our system ultimately needs to be fair and fair to everybody, and we need to have that balance.
I'm just going to ask a final question before we move on to part three. And it's regarding the role of the Scottish Prison Service in terms of trauma-informed practice. So the committee has heard evidence relating to the treatment of prisoners in a trauma-formed way. However, I'm just interested in how Cabinet Secretary would envisage the provisions within part two of the bill impacting further on the role of the Scottish Prison Service, with particular reference to victims and witnesses. So, for example, perhaps in and around the victim notification scheme?
Yeah, yep. So, in terms of this bill, the Scottish Prison Service are required to comply with the new principles in and around trauma-informed practice in its work with victims and witnesses. And the main way in which SPS interacts with victims is through the victim's notification mm-hmm. scheme. And, of course, that has been subject to a full independent review. Myself and the Minister for Victims and Community Safety, you know, will be coming forward with our conclusions and a response to that review, you know, either by the end of the year or at the turn of the year. And, of course, that review, I think, focused a lot on, you know, communication with victims and how there could be a more person-centred approach and, you know, people's rights to engage with particular processes. Other work that is relevant in this regard, there's a stream of work under the Victims Task Force that's particularly around communications and written communications. Mm-hmm. And that is of importance, you know, for organisations, you know, whether it's the Crown Office, whether it's, you know, the Scottish Prison Service, because I think we will all have heard testimony about the nature of written communications, which can be, you know, at times somewhat impenetrable. And more broadly, in terms of the Scottish Prison Service, I mean, they're involved with the people at heart approach to communication and the trauma-informed approach for prisoners. While it's not in this bill, because this mm-hmm. bill is about victims and witnesses, I mean, it is part of their corporate plan.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much for that. So we'll move on to part three of the bill, which is the proposal around extending special measures in civil cases. And I wonder if, again, if I can just come in with the first question. And it relates to evidence that we receive from Scottish Women's Aid, Rape Crisis Scotland and Victim Support Scotland. And they argued that the categories of witnesses who should be deemed vulnerable should be broadened further beyond what is in the bill, and that special measures should be available automatically for witnesses that are deemed to be vulnerable. So I just wondered if the Cabinet Secretary would now consider potentially amending Part 3 just in recognition of those comments that were, or that evidence that was given.
So again, Convener, I mean, I'll always work with members and stakeholders to, you know, discuss concerns, and always in the business, I hope, of demonstrating that we'll look at, you know, what's in there of the possible. I do think this is quite a difficult area, and I just say that for reasons of transparency. I mean, this part of the bill is about, you know, improving access to special measures, because we know, and we've heard this over a number of years, that people have felt in the civil courts far less protected, and particularly in and around where domestic violence or abuse has been is a feature of the case. So our approach thus far is that where there are civil protection orders mm-hmm. in place, so if that's an interdict or a non-harassment order, or whether there are convictions or indeed live proceedings, that would trigger the special measures automatically. And it would be the court that would have discretion in other circumstances. So always happy to discuss and consider further. I am also aware of other evidence that committee got from the Family Law Association mm-hmm. that's expressed some caution.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Any other members want to come in on part three? Russell Finlay? Russell Finlay.
Thanks very much. Thank you. When you were here in September, I raised the issue of what some victims groups have described as being legal system abuse. An example of that is when a domestic abuser uses connected civil and criminal cases to cause a further unnecessary delay. And it was suggested that having a single sheriff could deal with civil and criminal cases in tandem to help tackle this. You said at the time you welcomed the logic of that, you saw the logic of it, and that the Scottish Government would take an interest and you would consider working with possible way of amending the bill. And I know it's only been 7 weeks, but I wonder if you or your officials have had any opportunity to explore this any further.
Yeah, so I remember our exchange well, Mr. Finlay, and I can indeed see the attraction or potential benefits of such approach, bearing in mind that I think one of the core concerns is the lack of information and the lack of connectivity. If there's different information and procedures going on in different courts. I've certainly discussed this further with officials. This would be a major piece of work. And again, I'm just being upfront and direct about that, Mr. Finlay. This would be a substantive piece of work. Now, that doesn't mean there isn't merits in exploring it. It might limit what could be achieved via an amendment. It is an area, if you were talking about integrating courts in certain circumstances, it would certainly require full consultation with stakeholders and indeed with the Lord President in terms of his unique duties and responsibilities. We are planning some workshops on this and to look at the issue more fully. There isn't the fullest of evidence. There's some evidence around this in terms of the states, but there's not a wide range of evidence, but we will continue to look at it with our stakeholders in terms of these workshops, which will be next year, I have to say, Mr. Finlay, but I think we would also have the desire to look at the issue in and around court rules. And I know that more recent changes to court rules have focused on doing more to get the right information to support earlier action, particularly in family cases. So they have introduced measures around initial and full case management hearings. And so if there's further information, I'd be happy to provide that to you separately.
So just to recap, the workshops that you mentioned, they are not specific to this legislation?
They're not specific to this legislation, but they're specific to the issue of integrated domestic abuse courts.
Right, yeah. Because I think the Scottish Women's Aid told us there hadn't been any meaningful research in Scotland on this particular issue. There is existing research elsewhere in the UK. Yeah. But I noticed you also said that this would be a major piece of work. But I guess the legislation is already a major piece of work, not least the controversial intent to have, judge-only rape trials. So I just wonder, given the fact this would need consulted on. Does that make any proposed amendment unrealistic at this stage? Is it too late?
I can't read your writing, Simon, but I'll bring you in a minute. I am keen to manage expectations, Mr. Finlay, bearing in mind some of the discussion we've had about cost, about the need to be in a position to implement legislation. What I don't want is for amendments to be agreed, and then, you know, once we've got royal assent, we're then sitting with the issues of how do we implement some of this in practice. So it's just that bit about not putting the cart before the horse.
I suppose as a member of the Parliament, I'm trying to understand the process, because you know, you might bring forward an amendment with good intent, but if the necessary work's not been done to assess the cost and so on, then it creates more problems potentially.
Yeah. So I would be a bit nervous about an amendment on something so substantive, but that doesn't mean there isn't merit in pursuing this work further.
And with the full weight of the government behind it, we could get it done.
We've got a lot more work to do. You're a chancellor.
Thank you. It's the nicest thing you've ever said to me.
Oh, but we've got a long journey to go together, Mr. Finlay.
Yeah.
We'll be pals by the end of it.
I don't doubt it. Thank you.
I thought you were going to say something else there.
Sharon Dowie and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you. Just a question again on previous legislation. So 3 years on the special measures in the 2020 Act are not enforced yet. When does the Scottish Government aim to have Part 3 fully operational?
Right, OK. Two parts to that. I did write to committee in response to the convener's letter. It's a very, and it's, you know, fair points. I hope I've managed to give some reassurance that there is intensive work underway. We are living with the reality of, you know, a major global pandemic that undoubtedly, you know, interrupted our justice system and the implementation of legislation. Although I do want to give committee the assurance that that's something I'll always test. In that, because I know that folk get a bit weary of hearing that we're still living with the ongoing consequences of the pandemic. While that's true, I'm conscious that folk get weary of it. And I will want to, you know, always absolutely test pace and progress. And I hope I've given some reassurance to committee in terms of legislation that is still in progress of being implemented. In terms of timescale for special measures, right. Now, there are some complexities to this, and I mean, you'll know the purpose of the special measures. There is one area that will require particular detailed work, that will require regulations, consultation, and, you know, a considerable amount of work, and that is around the creation of a register of solicitors. And the bill puts particular responsibilities on the government in terms of who we engage with, for example, Faculty of Advocates, and it places other actions on us. We need the register of solicitors. We need to establish the register. We need to recruit solicitors. There is consultation that would also need to be going in and around prior to any regulations being brought forth. And that piece of work underpins the policy drive in terms of special measures to, in certain circumstances, prevent people from representing themselves or leading their case in the civil courts. And that goes back to Mr. Finlay's point about people using civil courts and abusers being able to use it as a platform to further torment people who have been victims, one example being victims of domestic abuse and violence. So if people are not able to represent themselves, they do need to be represented, and that's about, you know, the fairness in their system, where we can't compromise the rights of any particular party. So in terms of part three, you're probably looking at around 2 years. So I'm just putting that on the record now.
Okay, right, thank you. You've actually answered one of my other questions, which was going to be, are you concerned that there wasn't a sufficient number of solicitors willing to be included in the register, but you seem to be doing ongoing work in that to recruit, so that answers that. So I'll then go back to the cost of it. You referred to the letter that you sent us out last night as well, excuse me, and that one does say about there are budgetary pressures in relation to implementing the Act in full, and that was £15 million a year. It also goes on about the Vulnerable Witnesses Criminal Evidence Scotland Act 2019. It's not yet been implemented beyond phase one. Again, domestic abuse protection all have associated resource implications. Again, there's another part that says due to resourcing and other priorities following the programme for government. I'm just wondering whether we should be looking at some of the legislation that hasn't been fully implemented yet, because that would have a huge impact on some of the trauma that victims and witnesses are facing, rather than trying to batter on, bringing on even more legislation that, unless we get the proper funding for, is not going to be implemented. Because one of the things in the Domestic Abuse Act, it was actually allowing victims to remain in the family home by enabling a social landlord to transfer a tenancy to a victim survivor. So again, making sure that we've implemented some of the previous legislation would have go a huge way in making sure that we're reducing trauma. So should we not maybe stop and look at some of the previous legislation, put the funding in there to get that implemented? Because I've already said, you know, there is a will within the judiciary to actually do trauma-informed practice.
So we're riding two horses at once, right? And that's just the way, that is just the way sometimes life needs to be. So yes, we are taking through this bill, and we're taking this bill through Parliament in tandem with the work to implement previous legislation. I suppose what I would say is that in terms of some of the specifics, so actually this bill expands the powers of the Children Scotland Act. So there's a good synergy between the Children's Act 2020 and this bill, in that we are essentially increasing the safeguards for vulnerable parties. The 2020 Act, in terms of special measures, focused on family cases, you know, the kind of Section 11 Children Scotland Act cases around, custody and disputes about contact. So we are, I suppose, taking the nub of part of that bill and expanding it more broadly into civil procedures more widely. I believe that's to be welcomed. It's what victims have been calling for. I would say that nonetheless there's progress being made with that bill. I mean, there was other aspects of that bill that are not directly related to this bill, in and around child contact centres, and ministers have had detailed discussions with the Care Inspectorate and hope to be in a position to lay SSIs soon. So there is progress going in that, but the bit of the Children's Bill that's relevant to this bill, the Victims and Witness Bill, is a good example of where we've taken a bit of movement in protecting people in civil proceedings and actually expanding that further, and will make more progress. Undoubtedly, in terms of the 2019 Act, the Vulnerable Witnesses Criminal Evidence Bill, which was in and around the introduction of pre-recorded evidence. We have made progress with that in terms of the High Court. And again, that work is phased, it's ongoing. Again, we'll get to it in later sessions in and around the Part 5 of this bill in terms of the Sexual Offences Court, where there will be a presumption of pre-recorded evidence. And just to say, finally, Convener, in terms of the domestic abuse protection issue, again, it's an example of where a bit of legislation was passed and there were practical issues in and around the implementation of it. Hence, my note of caution in some of our discussions around some amendments. Not all of the issues with the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2021 are with regards to finances. Some of this is in relation to how timescales laid down in legislation have an impact on the kind of operational justice agencies, and there are some challenges in how the views of children can be gathered in ways that does not cause them additional harm or trauma. And just to say, this is not in any way an excuse, by the way, but our experiences in implementing that piece of legislation are not dissimilar to some of the difficulties that have been experienced south of the border either. So just sometimes legislation is indeed complex. Sometimes it's more complex than anticipated in terms of implementation. But I do want to assure committee that is something that I will seek to mitigate as far as possible when we go through this bill process.
Okay, thank you very much. And just for the record, just to clarify that we received the letter that you sent earlier this week that provides an update on previously passed legislation, including the Children Scotland Act 2020, Victims and Witnesses Criminal Evidence Act of 2019 and the Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act of 2021. And that correspondence is now available online. So with that, I'll draw the session to a close. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary and officials, for joining us this morning. And we'll have a short suspension to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you, members. And our next agenda item is an evidence session on His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabularies in Scotland, thematic review of policing mental health in Scotland. And I'm very pleased to welcome to the meeting Craig Naylor, Chief Inspector with His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland, Mr. Brian McNulty, Lead Inspector of HM Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland, and Dr. Aaron Chopra, Medical Director at the Mental Welfare Commission for Scotland and HMICS Advisory Group Member. So a warm welcome to you all, and I refer members to papers 3 and 4. And I intend to allow up to an hour for this session, and I'm just going to invite the Chief Inspector to make some opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Convener and Committee. Thank you for the invite to come and speak to you this morning. Our report, the genesis of it was the work done by Lady Eilish Angelini about 3 years ago just now. And one of the recommendations was that there should be a review of the system that deals with mental health crisis in Scotland. I'd love to have done that collaboratively, but in the need of getting something done, we have gone out on our own. But recognising that we were not the experts in everything on mental health, we sought help and advice from people like Dr. Chopra on an independent advisory group. And I'd like to pay tribute to that group who challenged our thinking, challenged our understanding, and brought to the table with us some real experience from both lived experience and from research and from professional capacity across Scotland. Our report covers who the advisory group were, but you know, people like Penumbra, Includum, Vox Scotland, the Forensic Network and various others, including Dr. Chopra's own input, hugely influenced how we thought about mental health crisis when looking at the policing side of things. A few short comments, Chair, if you don't mind. We see crisis in mental health as a multifaceted, complex and challenging area. Mm-hmm. It's not one organisation's responsibility to deal with it. It is a whole system that needs to respond to make sure that the people who are facing challenges in their mental health, whether that's a mental health diagnosis and illness or a crisis in the moment, are dealt with in a way that improves their well-being in the long term. My review team spoke with a large number of officers, and we heard the voices of people with experience. And we were aware that people with experience often see police officers as a safety net, people who can respond to them and provide an empathetic response. We were hugely impressed with the officers and staff within Police Scotland who respond, who have to deal with people at their lowest point often, and who do this in a way that tries to make sure that there is no worsening of their condition, but in terms of putting them into the right place to get the right treatment. Many officers that we spoke to believe that they're currently filling a gap, and that gap is the one that causes us concern. The gap is either a health, a social care, or a wider societal gap that there isn't someone to look after them in their moment of need. I've talked about Vox Scotland, and they'd conducted a report on our behalf from people with lived experience of mental health, and reading that hugely influenced our thinking, particularly when people describe about police officers coming and stopping things getting worse, but then being placed in the back of a police vehicle, often in handcuffs, often with a blue light on, often going to an accident emergency department to sit for many, many hours. This did not improve their well-being. This did not improve their mental health. It may have got them into some form of treatment, but what damage has been done in that intervening period between the crisis moment and the treatment occurring? When you go back to the creation of Police Scotland and the legislation, the Police and Fire Reform Scotland Act 2012, the remit of policing in Scotland is slightly different to that in England and Wales, in that there is a requirement to improve the well-being of people and communities in Scotland. And Police Scotland hold that very dear. They work and strive endlessly to do that. As part of our work, we looked at what is happening in England and Wales and what is described as right care, right person approach, which has been implemented by Humberside Police, the Metropolitan Police, and now many other police services across England and Wales. to my view, there is a lot of merit in some of the things that they do, but it doesn't meet that well-being responsibility that Police Scotland have in terms of their community and personal well-being. As such, we have not recommended that Police Scotland follow suit and implement it as England and Wales have done or are doing. We do think there's some learning from it, though, particularly in understanding what responsibilities Police Scotland have, and rather responding to every piece of demand that comes to them and every call for assistance that comes to them, to being a bit more discreet in their thinking on that and responding more effectively in that space. What we saw in a lot of the things that we found were that police officers join policing on the back of an advert which shows them jumping out of helicopters and riding fast cars and so on and so forth and responding to crime. The reality is often very different in that they spend a lot of time looking after people in crisis. We found that the training to support that is not as good as it should be, and that should be changed. We found that the management structures that oversee this are often risk-averse, are often concerned that something bad will happen and that there will then be an investigation by the PERC into what the officers have done. Mm-hmm. And we find that this almost paralysis, this terror of doing the wrong thing, causes officers to make decisions that are often about protecting themselves and protecting the organisation rather than the well-being of the individual in the longer term. And we totally understand why that happens, because that is the system that they operate within. And what we are keen to see is a different approach from Police Scotland, but more importantly, a different approach across the whole system, to understand how do we break down the barriers to effective service, how do we get people who are in crisis into treatment at a much earlier point, rather than being stigmatised by sitting beside a cop in a waiting room for a long period of time. The recommendations we've made, I've stepped out with my own authority and I've made a recommendation to Scottish Government to look at a whole system review. And I think coming to this committee allows me to start that thinking again and start encouraging people to join up the dots between silos and government and improve the overall outcomes rather than just improve bits of the system. We think that policing provides a really effective catch-all service and that that should continue, but there should be better ways of getting the people to the service and the treatment they need at an earlier point rather than staying with police officers for a long period of time. I would just like to reiterate my thanks to the Independent Advisory Group. They give us a lot of challenge, a lot of pushback on where we were, and they give us that sort of understanding that having a police officer deal with someone in a mental health crisis may not be the well-being improvement that we all think it might be. Thank you, Chair. Convener.
Okay, thank you very much for those opening remarks. And if I may just come in to kick things off, just picking up on your comments about management structures and how you want to see a different approach across not just Police Scotland, but across the whole system, justice system, if you will. And I'd like to reference some of the key findings in your report under the heading of leadership and vision. And just for the benefit of members, I'm just going to sort of tease out some of the points that you made. So in the key findings, you say there is a perception among officers that senior leaders focus, as you've outlined, on safe outcomes, seeking to minimise every possible threat, risk and harm. And this is normally achieved by police officers remaining with a person in crisis until they are either accepted into the care of the NHS or a family member. This approach to organisational and reputational risk results in a lack of focus on reflection and opportunities for improvement, often to the detriment of the individual concerned. And you go on to say Police Scotland cannot wait until a review of the whole system is undertaken before developing and implementing its own mental health strategy. We believe that the current situation is unsustainable. And just final point that you make in the following remarks, which is that Police Scotland must now develop and implement a mental health strategy and seek to understand its legal and moral position. and role within the whole system. So I'm interested, I think we all really understand and relate to those remarks. But in particular, in relation to that last point about understanding sort of legal and moral position, I wonder if you can perhaps expand a little bit to just help us understand what it is that you're thinking about in those comments.
Thank you, Convener. The legislation around how police can intervene in a mental health crisis is all focused on public space. And very often what we find is people who are suffering from some form of immediate crisis are not in a public space or in a private space, their home or somewhere similar. And there's an expectation that the police can come along and can take some action that will keep them safe, that will reduce the harm and will improve their well-being in the longer term. One of the difficulties we find is that there is no police power to enter a house, there is no police power to put hands on, there is no police power to take them to a place where they can get that treatment. And that puts the officers in a very difficult position because they then have to use their powers of persuasion, the powers of non-coercive power to encourage the individual who is probably not thinking as clearly as they would otherwise think mm-hmm. to go to somewhere other than where they may feel safe. So the legislation doesn't help in that space, but it also causes the officers to feel vulnerable themselves in that if they leave someone who is suffering a crisis, often a suicidal type position, and that person then goes and does something and harms themselves or even worse, takes their own life, the investigation will be into the conduct of the officers and whether they have done enough to mitigate that risk. Mm-hmm. Now, these investigations by the PERC are good, they're thorough, they come up when they're very balanced and proportionate, but they are difficult for any officer who has tried to save someone's life to go through that whole, not only feeling guilty that something's happened, but then having the investigation into the circumstances that has mm-hmm. taken place. So it is a complexity, it is difficult, it is challenging. And what we found in our inspection is that the policy that sits around it within Police Scotland is not as clear as it could be, that describes the roles, the requirements, the powers, the policies and the expectation on the officers. Mm-hmm.
And I think, thank you for that. And I think, you know, given we probably all in our constituency and regional roles speak to our local, to local police officers and hear just the volume of calls of this nature that police officers are attending. And so on that, have you had any discussions with Police Scotland as to how they will take forward the recommendations in the review, just given the sheer commitment that officers and police staff are having to make to this particular policing challenge?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, we've had a number of conversations. Most recently, when Dr. Chopra and members of the Independent Advisory Group came along to a meeting at St Andrew's House, where we introduced the Independent Advisory Group to Police Scotland senior leaders who are responsible for taking this forward. One of the recommendations is that Police Scotland make use of the Independent Advisory Group and the expertise that they bring. Mm-hmm. And it was a very warm and, you know, I'll allow absolutely Dr. Chopra to speak for himself, but it was a very positive meeting and a lot of good ideas coming on the table about how to take steps forward against many of the recommendations that we've made in this.
Yeah, okay, thank you. And I wonder if I can maybe just come to Dr. Chopra just to pick up on something in your report, your Mental Welfare Commission report, that reviews the repeated use of place of safety under the Mental Health Act. And in your key findings, one of the things that you have included is that the rates of conversion for all Section 297 detentions to emergency or short-term detention are around about 15%. However, this is about three times higher than the rate amongst those being repeatedly detained by police officers under Section 297, which is at about 5%. Now, I know from my past experience that recourse to a place of safety is not an uncommon course of action for police officers. So that figure of 5% is incredible. And I just wondered if I can maybe just bring in Dr. Chopra just to maybe talk further to that particular finding?
Morning. And thank you, Convener. Can I just start by saying it was a privilege to work with other members of the advisory group and colleagues from HMICS on that report. Mm-hmm. I found the HMICS team very responsive to the discussions that we held, and it was very open and helpful discussions that we took that took place to bring ideas forward. Thank you for highlighting the finding that we mentioned. That's specifically around the use of Section 297 powers, and it's specifically around the point of people who are repeatedly detained under Section 297. So whereas we see people who are being detained under Section 297 having subsequent detentions in about 15% of the cases, when people are experiencing repeat detentions, it's only 5%. Now, that suggests that those people who are experiencing repeat detentions under Section 297 are less likely, much less likely, to be then requiring further admission to hospital. Mm-hmm. And that illustrates one of the major problems that we have. And that is that the Act is designed around mental illness, whereas actually what the police officers are often responding to is mental distress. And that's a key distinction that ought to be brought through. The second point that follows from that rather low number that the convener has drawn our attention to is that it probably means that there aren't the appropriate ways forward for that group of people, mm-hmm. and health professionals are left with a rather binary option of either admitting someone into hospital or nothing. And often then police are responsible in taking forward the next steps if this person isn't admitted. One of the other findings that we found from that 5% group, or from this group of people who are subject to repeat Section 297 detentions, is the absence of care planning. You'd expect that someone who is having more than one detention under a Section 297 would have a robust care plan put together by the health professionals who've been working with them in collaboration with Police Scotland so that this doesn't happen again. Also, if they're presenting in crisis, that there are alternative pathways for them. What we found is that up to a third of people who had experienced repeat Section 297s did not have a care plan. And for those who did have a care plan, Police Scotland had not actually been part of working and on that care plan. And many of these individuals will be known locally to the police service there and will be known locally to the health professionals. So we really think there's a massive opportunity here for collaboration between officers and clinical professionals on the ground in those areas to produce trauma-informed, person-centred care plans so that when people are presenting repeatedly, the default doesn't become place of safety, admission or nothing. Mm-hmm. It becomes an alternative. So that's the kind of key finding from that report. And I think it sits very nicely with the work of the HMICS thematic review, which really does call for that collaboration, that joint training. And I think that's the reason how these two reports really segue together quite nicely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you, and I would completely agree with that. I've got lots of questions I would like to ask by way of follow-up, but I've got a good number of members wanting to come in, so I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay, then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'll rattle through these as quickly as I can, because there's a lot to go at. Page 31 of the report states that police officers who attend A&E with someone of need and treatment are often left waiting, and that they suspect, and I'm quoting here, they are deliberately being provided an unprioritised service so they can remain in hospital and provide a visible deterrent to disorder. So in other words, police officers are being treated like NHS security guards and therefore being removed from the streets where they actually should be. I just find that to be shocking, and I just wonder what is being done to address this with the NHS.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. It is one person's view that we have replicated in this, but it's not the only time we've heard that. Having a visible policing presence in an A&E department is something that started many, many years ago. But what we're seeing now is often many parked police vehicles outside A&E supporting individuals in there who are in for either physical or crisis treatment for various different things. What's been done about it? Well, we have a structure across Scotland with a number of health boards, a number of divisions. Trying to get one minimum standard across Scotland is difficult. And one of the things that we make in the first recommendation is that this needs to be looked at as a system. And that's not a system for Dumfries or for Glasgow or for Aberdeen. It's a system for Scotland and establishing what is a fair and acceptable way of doing business. So what we're calling for is that that whole system is looked at and an understanding of where the blockages are, where the difficulties are, and whether there is, in fact, evidence to support the police officer's assertion that they're used as a visible deterrence when they're sitting alongside someone who's suffering a crisis.
Thank you. Now, you make 14 recommendations in the report. I don't know if I understood you correctly in your opening statement, but I think you said that the first recommendation might go slightly beyond your remit. Indeed, and that calls for a strategic review of the whole system from start to finish. I suppose the question, therefore, is if that suggestion has been welcomed by Scottish Government, whether it looks likely, and whether the other 13 recommendations are temporarily at least redundant until number one is either accepted or rejected.
It's a very interesting question. Yes, I am going beyond my remit. I am only entitled to make recommendations to the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland. But I'd much rather seek forgiveness and permission in some of these things. So what we have done is follow up on what Lady Eilish Angelini said about a combined approach to this, because it's not one organisation's responsibility to resolve mental health crisis and distress in the community. I don't think it makes the others redundant until that is done. And I'll come back to your point about what Scottish Government have said. We think that the other, and I think we say quite clearly in a number of places in the report, that Police Scotland do need to get on and do their own strategy and then review it once we come to a conclusion on the wider review. So there's a lot of work to be done, there's a lot of training to be done, there's a lot of understanding more effectively how police officers can work in communities to deal with that distress in the first instance. In terms of the response, you know, we had two members of the Scottish Government Health Department at the meeting with the IAG. There are plans being looked at and considerations being given to what does that look like, but as yet we don't have anything that is a terms of reference or
right.
Anything similar.
Thank you. I think Mr McNulty indicated he might want to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to follow up on that, really, and I think an important theme that came through our review was that actually there's been quite a considerable shift in the role of a police officer in this space. So Craig and I could reflect back to when we were younger officers, actually primarily dealing with crime, antisocial behaviour, being proactive in our local communities. And we heard a lot of frustration, actually, going back to your point about accident emergency departments, from officers sitting, waiting for considerable periods of time until somebody's medically assessed, and all the while they could hear the radio going with things happening in their local communities. So I think there are things that can be done in the short to medium term whilst that whole system review's waited on. One of those would be, I mean, the right care, right person approach that Mr Naylor referenced there. There's a lot of good work being done in terms of protocols around accident emergency departments. And I think that that's something that could be looked at in the shorter to medium term to tighten up on that. Because if officers arrive at what is essentially a place of safety, and I recognise it's not an ideal place of safety, but they should then be able to hand over to NHS staff and go back out and patrol.
Yeah.
And that was a frustration that we heard.
Absolutely, thank you. I mean, there's another line in the report, page 59, which really jumped out at me, and it says, quoting again, Police Scotland does not yet have a clear purpose, vision or strategy for its continued provision of mental health-related policing services. And it begs the question, why on earth not, given this has been such a big issue for such a long time? But can I just quickly, instead of asking a question about that, ask one final question about the report and what it doesn't cover? It's 80 pages long. It's all about policing of mental health issues in the community, but it doesn't address the issue of officer mental health. And that's not a criticism, but we've been working with police officers who have had often life-changing, career-ending mental health problems, and indeed the families of officers who've died from suicide. And I think there's maybe a sense that this report may have at least attempted to address some of these issues. And it doesn't. I just wonder if HMICS is intending to do that as a standalone piece of work at some point.
Thank you. We will publish in January a report on wellbeing. We're calling it a frontline focus. So it's very much about the frontline of policing, how police officers are dealing with their own mental health, how their supervisors are supporting them, what support mechanisms are in place. We don't have a date yet, but sometime in January we'll come forward with that report. We've done most of the field work. You won't be surprised, and I sat in some of your sessions with some of the officers, so thank the committee for that opportunity. But what we are very, very clear on is that this is a challenge, and this particular part of dealing with the public can be incredibly challenging for police officers.
Of course.
So they are absolutely interlinked.
Yep. Okay, that's fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie and then Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Aim. I think my question will maybe come under the strategic review of the whole systems being needed, but I've also heard comments that the police are kind of running an out-of-hours service, because it basically seems to be that after 9 to 5 and at the weekends, so evenings and weekends, that's when a lot of their time is taken up with dealing with mental health issues. Is that something that you recognised when you were doing the report? And is there enough work currently being done just now with other agencies to go and address that issue so that they can actually give police the support they need out of hours?
There are some very good pockets of practice across the whole of Scotland, but there are pockets of practice where that doesn't happen, where there is a more of a 24/7 capability. And we've seen some action by Police Scotland to have health advisers in their control room, to have pathways that can direct people into the appropriate service. but these have all been driven by policing with good collaboration from local partners. There isn't one national standard that fits the whole of Scotland, and that is where we, to my view, need to be getting better. But yes, we've heard the anecdotes, and when I was a detective inspector and many years ago, we'd see it at 4:30 on a Friday afternoon, you get 4 or 5 phone calls from partners saying, "We're a bit concerned about Jimmy, we've not seen him for 3 days, we've been trying to find him, but we can't find him. Can you take him as missing? There might be a mental health issue." It's not new. That's 20 plus years ago. But I think what we're seeing is a growth in people being aware of concerns for individuals and then trying to get a service when there is no longer their service in place. It's difficult. How else do you deal with it? There needs to be a different thinking. We can't solve today's problems with yesterday's thinking.
Yeah. Okay. Did Brian want to come in?
I was actually just to address your point, but also go back to a point that Mr. Finlay made, that he said he wasn't going to ask us to answer, but it was a really important point. And that's that whole thing about, for me, actually, we did hear a lot about demand shift. That's what it was described to us as, that predominantly towards the end of the working day, end of the working week, or over holiday periods, Police Scotland experienced a lot of demand coming from agencies who were not able to deal with matters out of hours. So that was an important theme. The other thing, probably going back to the sort of whole system, for me, is that I do not think, reflecting back on the work that we did, that we have arrived at where we are by design. We've almost incrementally, year on year, got into a position where we're asking the police to do something fundamentally different from what they were asked to do 20, 30 years ago. That's why I think some of the legislation doesn't really sync with what we're asking of police officers. And we did, and this was Mr. Finlay's point about what is the purpose of the Police Scotland asking of its officers and staff. We heard a lot of confusion around that from officers and staff we spoke to. So some people felt that they were there to absolutely fill any gaps in the system. Others felt that they should only be dealing with the really high-end threat to life types of incidents. That wasn't only just with operational officers, but some very senior officers had different views. That's why we think, again, in the short term, Police Scotland really need to articulate what they expect officers and staff to do in this space, whether that be in a written down strategy or a communication to the organisation. For me, the piece of paper is less important. It's actually about making sure that they articulate to officers and staff what they're expecting them to do, and then train them in line with that expectation.
Okay.
like to come in?
Yeah, it's just to build on the points that both Craig and Brian have just made in response to your observation about the out-of-hours work and the fact that the police are often become the service of default at that point. And to build on this, there's some really good work taking place in the redesign of urgent care, the unscheduled care network that Scottish Government convene and hold. One mechanism to address the point that Craig mentioned about the fact that there isn't a single national way of ensuring consistency of response would be to align the psychiatric emergency plans that each health board has with the Police Scotland protocol for dealing with mental health and place of safety. So if the psychiatric emergency plans and the protocol for dealing with those situations are aligned, that might provide a degree of consistency and would be a mechanism to scale up some of the good practice that Craig has just mentioned.
Okay, thank you. And you mentioned earlier on about the enhanced mental health pathway, but it also says that in command and control, I don't think enough calls are actually being referred that way. So is there anything being done to try and train the people in command and control to make sure that they're sending the calls in the right direction to try and relieve police officers?
Yeah, so we interviewed service advisors who operate in the control room where calls from the public are received. And the pathway, I think, has got fantastic potential to get better outcomes for people earlier. But actually what we did find, and it goes back to this risk aversion, that there seemed to be some risk aversion with the service advisors, a lack of confidence, I think. And many of the advisors that we spoke to felt they would benefit from more training and understanding of mental health. And that's something that I have taken forward with the commander for Contact Command and Control Division. And they're already now, as part of the pathway, looking to refresh training. And I think one of the things that we really benefited from through the work of the advisory panel was getting lived experience. So that's something that we've asked Police Scotland to look at when they're developing the training, that they bring in lived experience of people. Because I think if you see the evaluation report, there's some fantastic work that the pathway has done. I think it's got great potential. But that was one of the areas where it could really improve in terms of giving confidence to service advisors.
So training's an issue. I'd actually written that down earlier on. They're scared of doing it wrong. They want to protect themselves and the organisation. So is there more work still to be done in training, not only for police officers then, but also for command and control staff, so that they can actually know the right pathway and have the confidence to take the right action?
Yeah, okay. I think there's an important point there as well that Mr. Naylor mentioned at the beginning, how impressed we were with officers and staff we spoke to. That actually what came across really, really strongly was how much they care and they want to do their very best for people. And on a human level, if they've been spending quite a bit of time with somebody, they do not want something bad to happen to that person. The other part of it is they've also got the potential of a PIRC investigation. But I would say that the interviews that I did, that was secondary. That they were more actually on a human level, just not wanting something adverse to happen to the person. And that could lead to a situation where they were remaining with the person, despite in some occasions having been told by mental health professionals that that's actually detrimental to the person's health. And it goes against their care plan. So for me, training is really, really important to empower and give people confidence.
Is that something that the police will be able to implement, it cost them?
Can I maybe just... Sorry. I've got quite a number of members wanting to come in. I know it's a really crucial part of this. So if I can maybe just move on and bring in Jackie Dunbar and then Fulton McGregor.
Good morning. If I could ask just a quick question regarding the delivery of the services for mental health policing. I am fully aware that Police Scotland is a national force, but I am also aware that some of the initiatives appear to be local based, which personally I think is best going forward. Former Grampian Police Board member, probably, so that's probably the reason for my thinking. But have you got any evidence to show that the local practices, you know, with the local division is having with the NHS services is actually being shared across Police Scotland, and you know, how would you expect that to be shared going forward?
It's a very good question, thank you. A lot of the practice is shared through the division within Police Scotland, who's got the responsibility for a mental health response called Partnerships, Prevention and Community Wellbeing. They have they're the sort of hub in the wheel with all the spokes as the divisions. What the difficulty is, to my view, is not so much the willingness of Police Scotland to take good initiatives that work well, that get better outcomes for individuals and reduce demand on the front line. It's the partners that they need to persuade to do things differently. And I'm not denigrating any of the partners, I'm just saying that sometimes the partners are not as willing to have the conversation because they're busy doing other things. So the "it's not invented here" sort of question can be difficult in some places. And this is why we're saying that I recognise that local is really good and having that local capability is really where we want to be, there needs to be a national minimum standard. So what is the minimum you can expect? And then how do you enhance that with a local initiative that meets your geography or capability around what you've got?
Yeah, and just to be clear, I am keen on that, but I'm also aware that one size doesn't fit all.
Absolutely.
But also we do need a national approach to things.
Thank you.
Brian was wanting to come in,
convener. Sorry. No, I was just on that. I welcome your comments on that because I think local, what I wouldn't like to see is that a whole system review would stifle some of the really excellent local initiatives that we saw. So the Nuke in Perth, the network that Dr. Chopra mentioned there is one way, the unscheduled care network where good practice is shared. And we heard of good practice in Forth Valley and Edinburgh and Perth. There's lots of really good things happening out there, but it doesn't seem to have a strategic oversight or coordination of. So I think we certainly wouldn't want to stifle that.
Thank you.
Much. Apologies for my lapse there. Fulton McGregor, followed by Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good afternoon to the panel. Thanks for your evidence so far. I've got two questions. One, it's just been mentioned a couple of minutes ago, and that's around about missing people. I'd done a wee bit of work on this in the previous session after a very tragic incident in my own constituency, not long after I was elected, actually, in 2016. And I know that the police were working through a review at that point about how they were dealing with missing people. And now we'll all be familiar with our social media feeds sharing very early, something that you know was well fought for, and I think it's a very good thing. And the police engaging the public in those searches. But something else that came through that as well was the mental health component in missing people. Did you find that when you were doing the review? Is that something that came up when you spoke to officers in the context of missing people? And how were the police dealing with and managing that particular component of a missing person inquiry?
Can I maybe touch on a couple of things and I'll pass over to Brian if that's okay? As part of our scrutiny plan, we've committed to doing an inspection of missing persons, and we will be published in terms of reference, I think, next week on that. It follows on from comments I made in my annual report this year, which described from Police Scotland statistics that on average it takes up 900 full-time equivalent officers per year dealing with missing persons. Of the missing person demand, I think, from recollection, about a third of the missing person demand is people who have a mental health diagnosis. So it is a massive problem. It is something which is absolutely huge. We're committed to trying to join up a number of bits of the system, mental health being one of them, missing persons being the next bit in our journey. And we seek to look at the process for dealing with missing persons to understand how vulnerability is built into that, and then how that is shared with partner organisations to make sure that there is more upstream preventative type activity from people who have gone missing and then been found who have a mental health reason behind that.
Brian, if you want to come on.
Yeah, no, so there were a number of issues associated with missing persons that arose throughout our review, and I have been sharing those with my colleague who's just starting a missing person review. It was deliberately left out of the terms of reference for this work, and the knowledge we're going to do a thematic inspection of missing persons. But one of the other issues that we heard a lot of challenge around was, again, going back to the accident and emergency department. So one of the other reasons officers would give often for remaining with somebody until they are assessed is that if they walk away and that person then walks out of that hospital, that the hospital will often report the person as a missing person, which will then lead to a lot more demand on the local police services. So, and that was another thing that we found in terms of the right care, right person approach in England and Wales, where they're really tightening up in the protocols there, because actually in most occasions, the reason why somebody leaves A&E is because they've got to a stage where they've just decided they're going home. They're not technically a missing person in most occasions. So I think the protocols around that are really, really important, because missing persons, you know, investigations, they're so important. But one of the risks is if you've got too many, then it's how do you prioritise them? So so that was another thing, theme that came out of the review.
OK, thanks for that. That's really interesting to hear. And I'll be interested to hear the findings of your future work around missing persons, as I'm sure that the rest of the committee. Well, as well, the second question, if that's all right, Convener, was around about your recommendation that you've already spoken about at great length for Police Scotland to produce a mental health strategy. I wondered if part of that there was any thought given to actually embedding health professionals within the police structure. And I know there's some work around that, but actually as part of this. So, because I think the unfortunate nature as well, it's a multi-organisational approach. The police is the first responder for many people, whether it's the person themselves or organisations. So was there any thought given to or any discussions around actually embedding mental health professionals as employees directly of Police Scotland to assist, or was this, as I imagine, just a pie in the sky idea for me?
It's a very interesting concept, and one that I've done in the previous organisations I've been responsible for. Where we had mental health professionals working with police officers in the car, doing that response type to the mental health crisis. It can work, it can work very well. It sometimes then blurs the boundaries between what is a policing response and what is a health response. Now, I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but it's how do you govern that, and how do you make sure that the clinical responsibility of a health professional is not compromised by sitting in the car with a police officer, sharing of information, all these sort of things. In terms of telling Police Scotland to employ mental health practitioners, that's not something I feel we should be doing. What we should be doing is saying what we expect the outcome to be, which is an effective strategy to guide police officers and staff within Police Scotland on how they deal with people in crisis and distress. If that then is Police Scotland employs someone who's a mental health professional to guide them on that, I would have no difficulty with that. But it's not something I feel I should tell them who to employ or how to employ.
Fair enough.
Okay, thank you. Rona Mackay, followed by Pauline.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon. Mr Naylor, you used a phrase in your opening statement way back that intrigued me a bit, and I wonder if you could maybe expand on it and maybe put it into context of what you said. You said that the officers responding should perhaps be discreet on thinking, and I wonder if you could sort of just expand on what you meant by that. Was that in response to inquiries? Would they have to take a more nuanced position? Is that what you were saying?
We ask a lot of our police officers. We train them, hopefully we train them well. We guide them and coach them the first 2 years of their service, and we basically let them off the leash at that point to go and make decisions in critical difficult situations. So we want them to be thinking the best outcome for the individual. We want them to be really challenging all the options that are available to them when faced with something that is developing in front of them. One of my former colleagues used to call it the strategic police officer. I'm not the person that sets strategy for policing. It's the person at 3 o'clock in the morning that makes a decision, often the most junior member of staff that's on duty. That can often lead the service into either difficulties or great outcomes, and you want them to be great outcomes every time, but it's very, very difficult. So you want them to have clarity of thought, clarity of purpose, clarity of training,
to make them able to make good decisions when they are faced with something that they've probably never seen before.
Yeah. And I think it goes back to what Ms McNulty was saying, and everybody's been saying about the importance of training and good, thorough training to give them confidence, etc. Can I ask you then about, you know, is there a changing nature of crisis calls that is happening, and are you finding that there's, you know, more of a having to respond to drugs, alcohol, homelessness? Has that been increasing, you know, over the years, or has it pretty much always been like that?
Did you want to
It's many years since I was a response officer in policing. And maybe it's rose-tinted glasses, but I remember responding to crimes. I remember trying to lock people up for breaking into houses and dealing drugs and things like that. What we're seeing and what we're told on a regular basis is the majority of the incidents that officers are sent to nowadays involves a crisis rather than a crime. Mm-hmm. So we see officers having to deal and go to accident emergency or places of safety much more than certainly Brian or I ever recall doing. Do I think that's a societal change? I think it probably is. I think certainly in the last 3 or 4 years since the pandemic, we are seeing more people who are in crisis, who are not able to deal with the situation that they're facing and are turning to the service that they know will come, which is either an ambulance service or a police service. Yeah. Do I think that's right? Well, the legislation has set Police Scotland up to do that, to improve wellbeing. And if people seek that support, then that's what they're going to get. But it has moved them away from dealing with housebreaking, break-ins to cars, etc., etc., which was our bread and butter when I was a young cop.
Mr. McNulty, do you want to?
Just on that point, actually, one of the challenges that we've highlighted within the report is that we heard anecdotally from all officers and staff we spoke to that demand is increasing. We also heard that from members of the advisory panel and other agencies. Everybody's saying that demand is increasing, and we certainly don't doubt that. But one of the challenges is that actually Police Scotland don't fully understand the demand at the moment, and that's something that there's more work needing done around, because it's very, very complex, actually, and there's different systems. So the question that you're asking there about, you know, is it more to do with drugs? These are pieces of information that would be really helpful.
Yeah. And I just wondered if you had that, and you clearly that's work that could be ongoing.
Yeah, so the demand and productivity unit within Police Scotland have done a lot of really good work to try and better understand the demand, but they themselves recognise they're on a journey with that, and there's more needing done.
Thank you. Dr. Chopra?
Yeah, certainly just on the demand point, there's very clear data available that shows that the demand has gone up. 10 years ago, there were maybe about 600 place of safety incidents, and now there's about 1,345, so you can see a doubling in that rate. The point I was going to make was around the training, and it was in response to what Craig was saying, but it's 3 a.m. when those decisions are being made. I think it would be really helpful for that training not to occur in a silo for just the police officers on their own, but for that training to take place jointly with health professionals. And I think one way in which that could be done is for the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland, with stakeholders, to produce a series of vignettes or case studies and road test them with Police Scotland officers and, you know, health professionals who are going to be involved at those times and other times, to actually see how would you respond. And that would take away some of that difficulty, which I think we spoke about earlier about risk aversion, because I think there'll be a shared sense of how to proceed in those together. In those cases. Yep.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill and then Katie Clark.
Thank you very much. Can I thank you for the quality of your evidence and how loudly you're voicing what I think is probably the most serious issue in terms of operational issues for Police Scotland. So I think that what you've done is so critical. I suppose the way forward's not that easy. I was really struck by what you said, for individual officers are terrified to make these decisions. So at that moment, they're trying to save a life and carry out their duties. But then it's the investigation as to whether they did the right thing. It just seems so grossly unfair to me. Um, So what is the answer to that, to prevent that from happening? Does it lie in page 11 where you said demand is passed to Police Scotland from partner agencies, the end of the working day and the working week? I think Sharon Dowie did ask you this question. I can't see any other way around this other than other agencies changing the way that they work. Am I getting this right?
You've hit the nub of the issue that we're all trying to deal with. I don't think there is one simple answer. There is no silver bullet that we're going to fire and that will answer all the problems. I think there's an awful lot about people recognising what their legal and their duties are in this space. And sometimes because of that fear of investigation, Police Scotland will go the extra mile because they are fearful that something bad is going to happen. And they do that for very, very good reasons and very often about they don't want people to become further unwell or take their own life or something similar. The difficulty we've got is written into law is that if there is death or serious injury following police contact within, I think it's 48 hours, then there will be a mandatory PERC investigation or referral to PERC investigation. And if there is a death where the police are seen to be responsible, then there will be a fatal accident inquiry. That level of investigation can last many, many years, and it puts people under pressure and affects their own mental well-being during that period of investigation. Police officers don't want that. Police staff don't want that. They want to get results where people who are in distress get the treatment they need very quickly and effectively, and that they then don't worry that something bad is going to happen.
Could I intervene in you?
So
does PERC, I was going to ask you if you had any examples of this, do they take into consideration then in the investigation that police officers are not trained as mental health officers? Do they?
The journey of PERC, and I'm not here to justify anything about PERC, they are in a very different position to where they were about 7 or 8 years ago. And the work that they do is very, very much about what is their statutory responsibility, which they will do, and then to investigate what is appropriate. And they will bring into that the evidence around what other parties have been involved. So they do cover that, but it's still they have a statutory responsibility that they can't walk away from.
Yeah, I understand that. But just finally, could I ask... Dr. Chopra, you said in answer to another member's question to align psychiatric emergency plans, and I just wondered if you could elaborate, because that seems to me to be part of the answer. Does that mean that the staffing as well, or is it just the plans? I just wanted to get...
I think the staffing is part of it. I mean, without the staffing, you can't deliver. And I think staffing has been a key issue across the mental health sector in terms of some of the problems that people are facing. But yes, what I mean by aligning that is that the protocol that the police use for responding to emergencies, for dealing with situations, ought to be placed in the context of the psychiatric emergency plan so that the Health Board and Police Scotland are singing from the same hymn sheet. I think that bit of alignment will make things work better. I just wanted to because I thought your previous question was a really helpful question, and we've spoken about some of the fear that police officers experience, but I do want to say that one of the things that we hear at the Mental Welfare Commission from patients who contact us, and we saw it in the Vox report as well, is how compassionate police officers are in responding to these situations. They're often described to me as the most compassionate part of the system, and I think that needs to be recognised. We've also spoken this morning and this afternoon about the right care, right person approach. One of the things which I thought was particularly good about the HMICS thematic review is the balanced approach it's taken to looking at right care, right person. Rather than saying we think this is the way forward, it's actually looked at those areas for which there is some evidence that this might be helpful in Scotland. And it's also kind of looked at the fact that there is some data that's not quite there yet in terms of what the outcomes will be in Humberside, in the Met, and in other places. So I think that's a really important point to make, that the data isn't fully out there. The short answer to your question, though, I think is collaboration. I think the key aspect is greater collaboration, both kind of at an operational level, but also at a strategic level, between health and policing. That is the way forward, and that includes training, as the example which I've given already. So it is kind of increasing collaboration which will prevent some of this huge demand that currently is falling to the police.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Before I bring in Katie Clark, can I just pick up on the comments that you've made? And I'm really glad that Pauline McNeill raised a question about psychiatric emergency plans. So having been part of the review of the Grampian one many years ago, I know just the spirit of what a psychiatric emergency plan is in underpinning that sort of collaborative approach to poor mental health, whatever end of the spectrum that might be. Should we then be looking at really developing the sort of role of psychiatric emergency plans to underpin all the kind of challenges that we've been discussing today? I'd be interested in your sort of commentary on that. And am I right in thinking that psychiatric emergency plans sit within the mental health legislation? So actually, we should be using them much, much more robustly.
To all of your points. I think that it's mentioned within the HMICS report, the code of practice is referenced from where that there's a clear reference to the psychiatric emergency plans. Yes, I don't want to get too operational, but one aspect could be that the psychiatric emergency plan requires that a care plan is created for someone who has come through Police Scotland and has accessed health through that mechanism. Mm-hmm. That would prevent, you know, but that would ensure that, you know, next time that person presents, there is a plan in place for them. So little ideas like that that could be embedded into the psychiatric emergency plan will make a whole scale change. And it builds on the work which Scottish Government's already doing with the redesign of urgent care. It builds very closely on the recommendations that Craig Bryan and the team have made. So I think it provides a really good mechanism to actually build on what we already have, rather than starting from scratch, which I don't think we need to do.
Yep. Thank you for that. That's most helpful. Mr. Naylor.
I just echo the comments that Dr. Chopper has made. His thinking on this, I think, is exceptional. Mm-hmm. And the point I would take is just a step further, that when these care plans are put in place, that Police Scotland should be notified of them and the contacts within them, particularly the sort of kinship family care that can be brought into that. That would take a long step forward to stopping people having to go to places of safety if you had that sort of mechanism to build in a family member or someone else that could assist.
Yeah. And when you say that, were you referring to the psychiatric emergency plans or individual care plans?
Individual care plans.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you. Katie Clark.
Yes, very briefly, and it's really around about data, in particular in relation to assaults, and we obviously are very aware of assaults on officers. Unison Scotland published a survey last week. It's a survey that's been ongoing since 2006, and it showed they'd been able to capture information about 55,000 assaults on public sector workers in Scotland, which was a 31% increase from the previous year. So in relation to civilian police staff, which obviously Unison Scotland organise, would you be able to point us in the direction or share with us data that you have in relation to issues, abuse and assaults in relation to them, or perhaps share with us any specific types of roles that have particular issues, because I know there's been a trend for a variety of different roles to move from officers to civilian staff.
I certainly don't think we've got any data that would be able to answer your question, so apologies for that. I suppose in terms of pointing you to where the sort of roles that would be in that would probably be the custody space.
Yes.
So police custody support officers who are interacting with people who are generally there on criminal matters, less so than on mental health matters, would be the space where I think there is likely to be an increase in assaults being recorded and reported.
Is that perhaps something that you could share with us, you could look into, and maybe if you are able to get any information, because there's obviously a range of roles that are public-facing that are carried out by civilian police staff, so perhaps that's something you could come back to us on.
So, I'm sorry, I'm not really understanding what you're asking me to come back on.
Well, if you're able to, you're speculating. So, do you feel that's as far as you can go? That's the strength, the level of the knowledge that the organisation has.
Yes.
That's what you're saying.
I think if you were to look for crime data on police staff being assaulted, that would be something that would have to come from Police Scotland.
OK, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask one final question and then we'll have to bring the session to a close. So it's more about where we go now. Obviously, many of the issues that we've discussed require to be addressed across organisations, third sector, public sector, and potentially also the Scottish Government. So I'm just, let me come to Craig Naylor first and then Dr. Chopra. And really just ask how you see this collaborative work going forward, and do you think this should actually be at government level? You might want to just answer yes or no.
We did make a recommendation to government to look at a whole system review. I'm ambivalent about what that review looks like. Mm-hmm. But what I want is people from health, from mental health, from social care, from policing, from third sector and others to sit around a table and consider what would good look like. We've started that process. Mm-hmm. We've had our IAG, when we did that introductory meeting with Police Scotland, we had all of these members present. And the conversation was incredibly positive. I think the conversation has started. The bit for me is, if we don't hear very much more by the end of January, we will start jagging people about how else can we encourage that conversation to go. And at the same time, we know that Police Scotland will be coming forward with an action plan to address the other recommendations that we've made. So the bit for me, Convener, is we're very happy to come back to you at some point in the future and give you an update on how things have gone, what that piece of work looks like. Mm-hmm. But rest assured, we will be sharp elbows out and seeking forgiveness rather than permission to ask government and others to do things that we think are the right things to do.
Thanks very much. Dr. Chopra, do you want to add anything to that?
I agree what Craig has just said. I think the collaboration needs to be strategic, operational, and at the level of training. Mm-hmm. So all three levels. And I think it needs to build upon the existing mechanisms that are already in place, because I think they are good and I think they are working, but I think they need to be built upon. Yeah. I think where there may be a role for a review is to look at some of the aspects which were picked up in an earlier exchange around what's happening locally. And Brian gave some really good examples of some areas where we know there's good practice. What is the mechanism for ensuring that scalability from those local practices, which we know are good, to make them national? Where is that discussion taking place? And maybe that would be a helpful aspect to have collaboration on, which Scottish Government might be very good at, or in a good position to convene and to scale.
Thank you very much. So thank you to all our witnesses. That's been a really informative session. I'm sure we could have continued asking more questions. So thank you again. That concludes the public part of our meeting. Next week, we'll review the evidence taken so far on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, and we'll consider a draft report on our pre-budget scrutiny, and we'll also consider correspondence received about deaths in custody and on the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018. So thank you very much, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.